State University in Tbilisi, and the director of social and cultural studies there since 2014. I would especially like to thank Georgi for managing to come to our panel in light of the ongoing events in Tbilisi. And I think right from the start, we would be remiss not to mention, we are speaking here about the 90s and the ways that the 90s history has been written. But at the very same time, we are witnessing events and developments, which I would argue have very much to do with the narratives of the 90s that we want to discuss here, namely the introduction of this law on foreign agents in Georgia, which is something that people from the Western Balkans can very much relate to, given the narrative of foreign intervention and foreign interventionism and this practice of having zero critical thought about the events of the 90s and conveniently pushing it over towards a foreign, almost metaphysical power that imposes the events of the 90s. We would also be remiss not to mention the ongoing developments regarding the adoption of the resolution on the genocide in Srebrenica, a 90s event which has stemmed from these narratives and a public discourse that originated in the 90s and has led to the wars of the 90s, but which remains a very much a living political issue in Serbia, but the entirety of the region. But I would like to start this panel with you, Corina, and I would like to ask you to lead us in terms of discussing the narratives of the 90s period in Russia, how they have evolved, how they have originated, and how they are used, I would say, to this day for political purposes. What's your take on this line, and why has there been a lack of serious academic study on this period, or rather how it has been co-opted by political forces to this day?
Is this working? Yes, it is. Yes, thank you. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the introduction, Milan. I think I would like to follow up a little bit from the beginning, from the first panel, because my idea was to talk a little bit about how history of the 90s is mainly not written yet. And I think we mentioned it in the first panel that we always tend not to talk about the 90s, but talk about today, or even about the Middle Ages. And somehow this is all connected, because the whole field is really very politicized and used for political debates. I think I'm not going to talk about how the 90s is used by Putin so much, because I think it's quite obvious. I would like to make a point which is about that the 90s are really hardly not historically researched yet. There is no careful analysis of sources, and we had this question today, what can be the sources? And as Claudia Kraft already mentioned, there are a lot of sources, we just have to take them and really start serious working with them. And my idea is that as a result of this lack, that there has been little academic debate on divergent positions, there is a lot of public debate on the topic, and this makes it so easy to use it in a polemic way, and also for different political issues. I also want to mention that I like the in Western Europe, the research which is done was also shaped by certain perceptions of Russia and Western Europe. So it's not like something that the research outside of Russia was more neutral or objective than in Russia itself. Also, in Western research, political positions, ideological preferences, and wishful thinking have shaped the perception of the idea, and like shaped the perception. And it was the idea that Russia would gradually develop into a democratic state. So this was the beginning, and then these kind of research on transformation, at some point ended, and there is a new narrative, which is like the criticism of neoliberalism, and this is like the state of the art in the moment that mainly this time is criticized as a root capitalization of Russia. And this is combined with a view of the 90s as a time of social decline and decay. To this is added the narrative of illegal privatization, which is seen as robbery and a betrayal of the people. And this was recently taken up by a series of videos produced by Navalny's team. I think some of you know this series, which is called, has this very questionable title, Traitors. And also the title and the content of this series of videos is, on the one hand, is somehow echoing the communist point of view, but also the Putin's view on this time. So this is these kind of political videos or talking about this time is, I think, is not very helpful. Of course, for Putin, to make it short, the 1990s as a time of chaos is clear. He can, in contrast, present himself as the guardian of stability, of security, and of order. So maybe some ideas what historical research should do in this situation. I absolutely agree with Claudia Kraft that we should describe the 1990s in all their diversity. I think the many possible paths of development should become clear. Democrats and liberals were not just people like Chubais or Gaidar, who are so unpopular today. There were many other people in the country who had a better vision of the future and who made concrete attempts to realize it. These positive beginnings must be rediscovered. But also the very many everyday problems have not to be overlooked. And also the racist, anti-Semitic, anti-democratic movements that did not start only in the 90s, but also have much older historical roots. And I think on the one hand, this differentiated view could help us to understand why Putin's regime has such and support. And on the other way, it can show us where there once seemed to be other paths of social and state development that could and hopefully maybe will be taken at a later date. So maybe I stop with this view on Russia. I could add some comments on the Baltics and Uzbekistan if this is needed somehow in the discussion.
Thank you very much, Karina. Here is where I would like to introduce maybe some parallels that were very, especially between the 90s and the narratives that have evolved prior to the 90s, but especially in the 90s, albeit in very different contexts. But there has been this this common thread of having to replace one memory and one. And you write, Georgi, about sites of memory, referring to Pierre Nora, and this notion of what the memory site constitutes, that it is not a physical object, but
rather much larger. So we can discuss these parallels between, I say I haven't been that familiar with the Georgian context. Your paper on the memory politics in Georgia has been very interesting for myself and for Ivan as well, because we have found many clear parallels of church's involvement and this sanctification of the profane, so to speak, for the use of the new and emerging narrative. Of course, in both contexts, one narrative needed to be replaced with the other for the purpose of the wars in the Balkans. The ruling elites needed to eliminate the narrative of brotherhood and unity, and the introduce this notion of Yugoslavia as the shackles of the Serbian people from which one needs to be liberated. And this served as the entrance point to the wars of the 90s. So that in mind, Ivan, I would like to give the floor to you and have you react on what I said, and also give us a brief your brief view on the dominant public and political narratives about the 90s in primarily Serbia, but I would also like us to have a broader picture of the former Yugoslavia.
Okay, thank you, Milan. Thank you all. Thank you, Heinrich Bell, for inviting me. First of all, as Corina also, maybe in the very beginning, I would like to exploit the opportunity to maybe refer first to something that is said on the first panel, and that is what Mr. Kaufman asked about the question about the history as contested as much as you can imagine in the context of Western Balkans. And I fully agree with him. So we are really witnessing today a very strange situation in the Western Balkans, and especially in Serbia, I can say, but in the whole region as well, because you said it reflects the region as well also. And we are witnessing definitely what he said, a contested history, and that we are entering some phase, not also what is mentioned in the first panel, that it is not post-truth. It is becoming some kind of fiction, or let's say literally work more than history, and the facts and are completely, absolutely neglected. And not only neglected, but you know, you are very often witnessing the situation where the historians, those who are mainstream historians, at least in Serbia, they are very aware of these facts, but they are completely, you know, overcoming that facts and pushing their ideological agenda and their ideas. And of course, what was also mentioned about the remembrance and politics of remembrance. Recently, Professor Dubravka Stojanović published a book where she referred to work of Pierre Nora, who you mentioned, and Jacques Le Goff, where she said that, you know, what we have now in Serbia, this is this politics of remembrance, where, you know, remembrance is always emotional, passionate, sacralized memories and remembrance, and on the other hand, history should be and is scientific, critical, and rational. So we are in really very strange situation. And Mr. Kaufman asked others, participants on the first panel, what we should do. And as we saw, no one gave some concrete answer and solution to this situation. Now, regarding the Serbia and the Western Balkans more broadly, as you said, in the dominant public and political narratives today, especially from the 2012 when the new political party came to powers, Serbian Progressive Party and current president Aleksandar Vučić, but not solely with him. It started already with the democratic changes back then with the democratically elected government. They started as well with some they made some very problematic decisions. But as you said, the Yugoslavia in the 90s, first of all, were portrayed as some kind of, that Yugoslavia was something extremely bad for Serbian interests, that popularly they are calling Yugoslavia as a dungeon of people, Stamnica Naroda. And they are saying that Yugoslavia, on many levels, they are on multiple levels, they are criticizing Yugoslavia regarding the redistribution of resources, unequal industrialization and investment, imposition, what you said, the brotherhood identity at the expenses of Serbian national identity, constitutional arrangements, especially one from 1974, because that constitution introduced Kosovo and Vojvodina, and that from their point of view endangered the Serbian homogeneity as a territory and so on. But I would like just to focus in this brief introduction remarks maybe to the things that are used for the reaffirmation, to newest reaffirmation of this ultra-Serbian nationalist agenda that is again in power in Serbia and that endangers the whole region again and brings huge instability into the region. And as you mentioned, in 2 days from now, we have in United Nations voting on the resolution regarding Srebrenica and genocide in Srebrenica. And it is portrayed in Serbia as some kind of, ultimate battle for the, of course, against the evil world, international community who wants to, collectively punish Serbian people and to declare Serbs as such as a genocidal nation. Three main themes I can say are dominant. This is the historical revisionism, culture of triumphalism, and external aggression. All of these are, as I said, used for this conceptualization of this new Serbian national identity, which has again, we can see the political goals. It is weaponized for political goals, which are directed toward Kosovo, first of all, and as well to Bosnia and Herzegovina. They are, questioning the sovereignty, or let's say trying to dispute the sovereignty of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Of course, I can stop here, but we can further elaborate on the different types and manifestations of historical revisionism. And what I find even more important, this concept of culture of triumphalism, which is connected to genocide, and how genocide is now turned into the glorious victory, and how the most despicable war criminals are turned into the individuals who are the source of the national pride and some kind of national unity. So, yeah, I can stop here, but these are some ideas for further discussion.
Thank you, Ivan. Georgi, I will give the floor now to you, and also you have this good opportunity because we've had already some discussion is going on, so you're free to react, of course. I would be interested in your view, also giving us a brief contextualization and the presentation of the dominant political and ideological features that helped build the narratives in Georgia in the 90s. And then we can also make some parallels with what the other panelists have said. And just a technical remark, Georgi will give his input in German, and our kind interpreter will translate it consecutively.
Ja, vielen Dank, Milan. Und ich kann auch, was ich erzählen will, auch mit der vorherigen Diskussion verbinden. 90er Jahren beginnen, in den 80er Jahren, in der Zeit der Perestroika und genauer gesagt 88, kommt diese Bewegung, eine neue Bewegung, kommt auf der Straße. Große Kundgebungen, Manifestationen, gerade jetzt in Tbilisi täglich, schon seit einem Monat, läuft das wieder gegen die Regierung. Und wenn wir aus dieser Sicht die ganze Vergangenheit letzter 35 Jahre auch betrachten würden, praktisch hat nicht vieles geändert.
I'll take this one.
Okay.
Okay, well, thank you very much for having me, first of all. And what I would like to share with you will draw some parallels on what we've heard before already. And when looking back on the 90s, basically we have to look towards the 80s already. So the 80s, where the perestroika was predominant, and starting in 88, basically, when a large movement started peaking, people taking to the streets, large demonstrations took place. And this is something that we see reflected right now in the current events in Tbilisi, taking plays in the streets 1 month ago when it started out. And so the whole movement against the government is something that is reflected in the whole history already. So taking back 35 years ago is what we see nowadays again.
Milan hat bereits erwähnt, die georgische Regierung versucht jetzt dieses Gesetz, sogenannten Agentengesetz, zu erzwingen. Eigentlich haben sie schon praktisch durchgesetzt. Das heißt, wird auch von der Regierung so behauptet, wir wollen unsere Souveränität verteidigen, sowohl vom Westen als von anderen Ländern. Eigentlich ist vor allem gegen westliche Institutionen gerichtet, NGOs, alle, die vom Westen, und es werden nur vom Westen finanziert, also daher ist dieses Gesetz eindeutig antiwestlich und wird auch als von den Demonstranten, von den Protestierenden als russisches Gesetz bezeichnet.
And as Milan mentioned already, the Georgian government is trying to push through the foreign agents bill, and they're basically forcing them on their population. The government claims that they're simply defending their sovereignty against the Western states and other countries, but this is basically only a Western initiative and only directed against the Western institutions, because NGOs are basically only funded by Western institutions. So we can really call it an anti-Western bill, and it is of course called as well the we have drawn parallels to the Russian law, or they call it the Russian law, based on what has happened in history in Russia already.
Daher heißt auch die ganze diese protestierende Bewegung auch anti-russisch, kann man so eindeutig bezeichnen. Und das liegt auch in einer Tradition, die sich genau in den 80er Jahren des 20. Jahrhunderts gebildet hat. Und ich werde aber auch ganz kurz die Hauptereignisse der 90er Jahren erwähnen.
Okay, so this is why it has been called by the protesters an anti-Russian movement, basically, because it goes back to the 80s and the tradition that was displayed in the 80s. I would now like to briefly lay out what happened in the 90s.
Also in den 80er Jahren hat sich in Georgien verschiedene Gruppen und Bewegungen gebildet, die haben einen Gesamttitel National Befreiende Bewegung. Diese Bewegung war eindeutig sehr nationalistisch und in häufigen Fällen auch ethnonationalistisch. Daher war schon klar, Georgien ist sehr multiethnisch, multinationale Stadt, multikulturelle Stadt. Und es gab drei autonome Gebilde in der sowjetischen Zeit, also zwei autonome Republiken, Adjarien und Abchasien, und ein autonomes Gebiet, Südossetien. 1990 fanden erste freie Wahlen in Georgien statt, und mit überwiegender Mehrheit hat die Wahl eine nationalistisch besinnte Bewegung, angeführt von künftig ersten georgischen Präsidenten Sviat Gamsachurdia, gewonnen mit absoluter Mehrheit.
So, going back to the 80s, we had different groups and movements present on the political scene, and what was predominant was the National Liberation Movement. So we know that Georgia is a multicultural and multi-ethnic country, so this very nationalistic National Liberation Movement represented the a very nationalist or an ethno-nationalist view. As you might know, we have three autonomous regions, Algeria, Abkhazia, and South Ossetia, that are those breakaway regions that have played a very important role in the history of Georgia. And when we come to the 90s, in 1991, the first free elections were held. And with an overwhelming majority, the first Georgian president, Sviat Gamsakhurdia, won those elections in a landslide, and he was a representative of the National Liberation Movement.
Die erste Entscheidung, die die neue Regierung 1990 betroffen hat, war Auflösung des autonomen Gebiets Südossetien. Das war Beginn der ersten bewaffneten Konflikte in Georgien. Danach, 1991 im März, fand das Referendum statt für oder gegen die Unabhängigkeit Georgiens mit absoluter Mehrheit, also über 92% Menschen haben für die Unabhängigkeit Stimme gegeben. Und 10 Tage später, am 9. April, wurde Unabhängigkeit Georgiens erklärt.
Ja. The first decision that this new government took was to the dissolution of the autonomous region of South Ossetia. This was the beginning of the armed conflicts in the region. This was the first one. Then in March 1991, a referendum was held on the independence of Georgia, and an overwhelming majority, 92% of the population, voted in favor. Only 10 days after, the 9th of April 1991, the independence was proclaimed.
Also einen Monat später gab es Präsidentschaftswahlen in Georgien und mit auch überwiegender Mehrheit, also 87%, hat Sviat Gamsakhurdia gewonnen. Aber danach kommt Putsch in Moskau im August 1991 und die Spannungen innerhalb des Landes wachsen. Ab September wird ununterbrochen gegen Gamsakhurdias Politik protestiert in Tbilisi, und das führt zu Ende dieses Jahres, im Dezember, zu Bürgerkrieg und Aufstand. Ehemalige Nationale Garde, gebildet selber von Gamsakhurdia, putscht gegen ihn selbst. Der Krieg dauert 2 Wochen lang und Gamsakhurdia wird aus dem Lande vertrieben, und die Macht übernimmt Militärkomitee, die aber nicht lange regieren kann, und wird Eduard Shevardnadze, ehemaliger Außenminister und ehemaliger Parteichef Georgiens, zog nach Georgien geholt und wird erstmals als Übergangsregierung gebildet, angeführt von Shevardnadze, und ab Oktober 92 wird auch gewählt, und Shevardnadze wird als Parlamentspräsident gewählt.
Then 1 month after, we have the presidential elections coming up, and another overwhelming majority reinstates Sviat Gamsakhurdia as the new president, and 87% votes in favor of him. But this doesn't really last for long. Then in August 1991, we have a coup d'etat, and a lot of tension builds up in the country. So as from the September, we have a lot of protests going on against the president in office, and in December, officially, a civil war breaks out. The National Guard that has been initiated by Sviat Gamsakhurdia is then exercising this coup against him. So after 2 weeks, we have a war going on, the civil war is going on for 2 weeks, Gamsakhurdia leaves the country, and the military committee takes over the power in the country. then a new person appears on scene, Shevardnadze, who's been a foreign minister and is a foreign minister in Russia and is coming back to Georgia in order to take care of the situation in the country. A transitional government is instated, and Shevardnadze is the new parliamentary president as from October 1992.
Aber die ganze Zeit wird weiter gekämpft zwischen Anhänger Gamsachurdias und Anhänger neuer Regierung. Und die Folge ist, dass im August 92 werden die Regierungstruppe marschieren in Abchasien ein. Und da beginnt auch Krieg in Abchasien, das über ein Jahr dauert, mit voller Niederlage georgischer Seite, also im Jahre 93. Danach würde ich sagen, dass endgültig der Krieg endet, eigentlich 93 praktisch Ende des Jahres. Und 95 wird Shevardnadze zum Staatspräsident gewählt. Gamsachurdia ist bisher unklar, wurde umgebracht oder hat Selbstmord begangen im Dezember 93. Und seitdem, erstmal vielleicht diese abschließend kurz die Hauptereignisse des der 90er Jahren, und dann werde ich über diese Narrative sprechen.
Okay, and then we have ongoing battles between Gamsachurdia and the new government, so there's really no pacification in the country. In August 92, troops from the government invade Abkhazia. This war goes on for more than a year with a defeat of the Georgian side. Finally, the war ends by the end of 1993, and in 1995, Shevardnadze is elected head of state. Then we don't really know what happens to Gamsachurdia. He's ousted from power. We don't know if he committed suicide or if he was killed. He simply disappears from the scene. And this is basically what happens in the 90s. And now I would like to draw a parallel and talk about the narrative.
Sorry, Georgi, could I interrupt you briefly at this point? Yeah. And maybe before we start speaking about the narratives, I would also throw in a little question of my own, and then also give the floor to the other discussants, and also remind our esteemed audience that this is an open format, so we would also expect somebody to occupy this chair and enter the discussion with us at any point. Yes, we are well ahead in terms of our time. So speaking about the narratives about the 90s and how they were, we are speaking about the narratives here about the 90s, but I would also like to speak about narratives originating from the 90s and how they intertwine together and lead us to what we have now in terms of knowledge and the place of the knowledge that is a scientific fact, as Ivan said, but is yet doesn't have its proper place in the official histories of the region regions that we are speaking about. I would also like to introduce this notion of that the democracy in the former Yugoslavia and also in the former Soviet Union was introduced in the 90s, and how my question would be to what extent the concept of democracy and the notion of democracy and the way that we study it in our internal textbooks and how it is communicated to children in schools is introduced by the fact that it came hand in hand with nationalist narratives and the public discourse that has in many cases led to violent conflicts.
Ja, das ist das Problem, dass es gibt zwei Hauptnarrative. Die erste aus dieser nationalen Befreiungsbewegung kommt, und das ist irgendwie so vor allem Unabhängigkeitsnarrativ, die in den 90er entstanden sind. Sehr nationalistisch, sehr orthodox, christlich, religiös geprägt. Zweites Narrativ ist Westernisierung, Demokratisierung, liberale Demokratie, Euro-Integration oder euroatlantische Integration. Das kommt aus der Umgebung von Shevardnadze. die beide Narrative koexistieren und haben auch Einflüsse übereinander.
Well, yeah, let's come to that problem. There are two main narratives I would refer to. The National Liberation Movement, that basically refers to the independence of the Georgian state. So this is what is predominant in the 90s, a very nationalist, very Christian Orthodox-based view. And then on the other hand, we have the westernization, liberalization, the Euro-Atlantic approximation. And this is basically supported by Shevardnadze. So both of those narratives are coexistent and overlap one another.
Hauptbezeichnung, also was man überall in Georgien heutzutage sehen kann, 20% of Georgia is occupied by the Russian. Das heißt auch, das ist eine ideologische Losung, ja. Das heißt auch, dass die Konflikte, die in Georgien stattfanden, also in Südossetien und Abchasien, wird eindeutig als russische Besatzung bezeichnet. Das ist auch ein Narrativ, aber anerkannt aus jeder Sicht, sozusagen liberal-demokratisch geprägt oder mehr nationalistisch geprägt.
Well, and then we have this slogan that says 20% of Georgian territory is occupied by the Russians, which is a slogan, but it's also the truth. So South Ossetia and Abkhazia are territories occupied by the Russians. This is another narrative, and it's well reflected by the liberal nationalist movement and the liberalist views, basically.
Was dahinter steht und was da überschattet oder verheimlicht wird, der Anteil georgischer Nationalismus in diesen Konflikten. Also es wird so bezeichnet, dass Russland diese Gebiete besetzt hat. Das ist auch klar. Also da stehen russische Truppen in Südossetien oder in Abchasien. Aber Anteil des georgischen Nationalismus, darüber wird geschwiegen nur. Praktisch. Also es gibt nur ganz wenige Forschungen, Aufsätze, Artikel, also Saarland Ronikaschwili sitzt hier und er war einer der Ersten, der über Anfang des Konfliktes in Südossetien geschrieben hat, und ich kann mich erinnern, wie die Reaktion gegen seinen Aufsatz war, was er publiziert hat, genau das, also das ist doch von Russland besetzt. Also das ist auch vom Krieg, russisch-georgischen Krieg 2008, sehr stark geprägt.
Of course, we defend the view that those are Russian-occupied territories, which is quite clear because there are Russian troops whenever you cross the border. And this is what is reflected. But there are only very few publications on there, very few articles, very few research. And I remember Sloa Antoshvili was one of the first to publish about the conflict in South Ossetia, and I very well remember the reactions on his publication. So this all goes back to the Russian-Georgian War in 2008, and it still remains a big problem.
Wenn es um Methodologie geht, da haben wir genau diese Schwierigkeiten, also wie kann man die wahre Geschichte sozusagen rekonstruieren, weil die Geschichte ist immer sehr stark von der Ideologien, von den nationalistisch geprägten Ideologien, die haben fest im Griff. Und die machen ein eigenes Bild der Geschichte, was auch in den Schulen gelernt wird. Und nicht nur an Schulen, auch an Hochschulen. Also das ist die Schwierigkeit ist, Neubewertung oder durch welche Methode kann man die wahre Geschichte sozusagen rekonstruieren, unabhängig von irgendwelchen ideologisch geprägten Ausgangspunkt?
And that's the big question when it comes to methodology. Of course, how do you reconstruct the true history independent of the nationalist ideology? It is very difficult. And this is how you can see how our history is depicted in the textbooks and schools, but not only in schools, as well in universities. So this is a very interesting idea of what are the right methods to really acknowledge the true history independent of each and every ideology.
Thank you, Georgi. Corina, you might want to react on this and maybe give us your view on this. Idea of democracy being, and as this conquest of freedom being lost, and the learning of and the writing of history when it comes to the especially early 90s and the perestroika period. You touched upon that in your opening statement, but it would be interesting to hear your take on it in more detail.
So you mean how the idea of democracy was lost?
And
was
how it
lost?
Remains to be lost, I would say.
Maybe I would answer to Georgi, and also really would like to encourage people to come in.
Yes, please.
As historians, this, like, what is the true history? I think this is one challenge we have, that we cannot pretend to write a true history, but we should try to make it clear where our history is not objective. So where are the subjectivities we have when we write history? What comes in my mind, Georgi, when you were talking, is maybe kind of a provocative question for the whole, for everyone here. Can we maybe see the 1990s as a ongoing civil war, which was not like in Georgia? We had a civil war between, you said, this like two factions, like the more Western orientated, still nationalistic, and the conservative, nationalistic, connected with the church, the same in Yugoslavia. And we had no civil war in Russia, but always it was the talk about there's a big threat, and we have to, it helped people like Yeltsin coming to power in 1996 to keep power, and Putin to stay in power. And we had this polarization in Ukraine. Do we still have a kind of a civil war in Eastern Europe going on?
We can introduce our new panelist, and maybe he can give an answer to that question.
Well, first of all, thank you all for wonderful discussion. And my name is Alexey Uvarov. I originally come from Russia, but almost 2 years live in Bonn, Germany, and writing a PhD on the use of succession topic in Russian politics in the 90s. So the topic is pretty relevant to me. I'll start with the notion that basically, and I see a big difference from in the issue of the 90s thoughts and concepts in Russia from other former republics of the USSR, is that, for instance, in Georgia proclaimed itself as the succession state to the previous Georgian Republic, Democratic Republic of the 1921, which was really crucial as well to the Baltic states and Azerbaijan Republic, Armenian Republic, and so it was a kind of a path to back to normality in a way. So we see a former republic which existed in the first half of the 20th century, therefore you could either go to the previous better image of how it should be. In Russia it was never a case, because before the collapse of the USSR it was the part of the USSR, and before it was their empire, so there was no clear vision of what could be done. Of course, I'm not basing my personal experience, because I was just born in 1996, but just on the study and sources. And therefore, I believe that Russia really lacked this image of what could be done and what democracy really is. And I believe that also Russia lacked a lot the such a big movement for democracy and freedom as Solidarność in Poland, for instance, because it was really a very small a number of people who will be able to create this image and also then be lost because of the economic reforms and the clash between the president and the parliament. And I would also like to comment on your, if I may, assumption of the movie. I'm really glad you mentioned the Traitors series. I find them also a bit confusing in a way, but I would say that you mentioned that it's kind of echoed the Putin's vision of, or communist vision of the 90s. And I agree, but I believe that one of the aims of this series was to show that Putin didn't actually end the 90s, but he was actually from the 90s. So the third movie is only about Putin's career, which started in the 90s, being connected to the criminal groups and so on. So basically it's saying that there is no any difference between the violence, corruption, assassination attempts whatsoever in the 90s and in Putin's Russia. Basically, all we see now, it what happened already in the 90s, but not in the same scale. So therefore, this message could be a bit helpful just to see that Putin is not an exception, or there is no any contradiction between the 90s freedom fight and the Putin dictator, but he is from 90s, basically. And the last thing, I guess, concerning the history of 90s, I think that the historical studies for now still lack a bit of understanding the role of institutions of democracy in Russia, how they failed to be built in this very short period. And, well, I guess that's what the Navalny team also failed, the idea which comes after the movie. So they basically said that the Putin is bad and the old Democrats are also bad. But what's from that? So that's the issue. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. I totally agree that after the film, there is lacking this idea what I wanted to mention, that what other paths would have been possible, and maybe there were other paths. And concerning the crash of institutions or why they weren't able to build up democracy, I think this is one of the main questions we really have to work on. Because I think in Russia, I don't know how Serbia and Georgia and other republics, there are quite good institutions, and there is a good constitution, and there were many changes, but institutions themselves don't help if the political culture is not using them in properly way. And that what the problem we had, or the topic we had in a project we had together with Skorgi on the legacies of communism, and it was mainly about the networks which are still working, and they used like the institution in their way, and of course legacies of political cultures which weren't democratic and were not used to use these democratic institutions.
Well, actually, I totally agree, because I feel like that post-Soviet countries have gone through this rise of nationalism in the 90s. And I guess majority of countries did come through this, which is normal, because I guess nowadays these countries, like both Baltic states, South Caucasus states, Belarus, Ukraine, have gone to the current understanding of what a national state is. And for Russia, and what we see now with the rise of nationalism, which might not have taken such a big place in the 90s, but now we just see that Russia actually has never seen itself as a nation state. And only now it's going through a very strong and catastrophic wave of nationalism and anti-Semitism altogether. And I believe that maybe this experience might then kind of lead to something which could form Russian understanding what Russian Republic is, what Russian nation is. But I'm afraid that all these things are now more formed on the basis of imperial past than civic understanding, so to say. Yeah.
I would maybe just add, some kind of a Serbian experience regarding the 90s and what you now are referring to, the rise of nationalism and so on, and democracy. So, for example, in Serbia, we have to bear in mind that for decades, at least two decades and a half, we had this consolidation of the national, pro-national forces under the socialist regime. So when the social regime went down, more or less these pro-nationalist forces in Serbia were the strongest ones. So and the first democratic elections and subsequent afterwards, they were constantly the best organized and the most powerful one. And also the narratives of this, they very successfully draw upon this continuity of Serbian statehood before the Second War, and also the things that were going on during the Second World War. So To my knowledge, and also as I'm, as you said, a political scientist, I am very, to me, it is very problematic that you distinct liberal democracy and so on with nationalism. It, for me, it goes hands in hand. So I don't think this is at all anything unusual what happened, especially if you take into account that, you know, there was, in fact, some kind of a repression on the socialist regime and so on and so on. So, you know, that was to some degree, we could say, expected outcome. Of course, a lot of us believed that it wouldn't be such a bloody war. But, and until now, this is what I said in the first introduction remarks, regarding the discontinuity, even after the democratic change in the beginning of 2000, the democratic, or let's say pro-European forces, they introduced, for example, what you mentioned, Orthodox Church. Orthodox Church entered big time after the socialist dictatorial regime of Slobodan Milosevic. Okay, he was to some degree using the church, but not in a sense that, you know, and he didn't give the, so much privileges what the democratically elected government gave. And what is also very important, the democratically elected, or let's say pro-European Union, blah, 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 they rehabilitated those who were in the Second World War, the collaborators of the fascist regime. So it is a very interesting situation that, you know, those who won on democratic elections, who were Democrats, they were Democrats, and they were, after, you know, in the 2012, you had more or less democracy in Serbia, but still their main narrative was nationalistic one. And just to conclude, one of the ideologues of one of the most important democratic parties in Serbia, Ljubomir Tadić, a famous also philosopher as well, he said, you know, we cannot never, when he asked from Olivera Milosavljevic, a very famous historian in Serbian, so he said very openly, Serbia cannot leave Kosovo and Bosnia and Herzegovina, especially now than what we did during the 90s. So you see this perversion. So he's completely aware what Serbia had done in the 90s, but he's saying, if we already done this, now we cannot give up our hands on Bosnia and Kosovo. And these are the pro-European forces.
So, kleine Bemerkung auch, also es gibt so viele Ähnlichkeiten zwischen ehemalige jugoslawische Geschichte, vor allem serbische Geschichte und georgische Geschichte oder kaukasische Geschichte, dass man manchmal denke ich, dass es irgendwie so georgische Geschichte lese, wenn ich aus serbische, also aus den 90ern Serbien historische Pakten betrachte. Aber es gibt wahrscheinlich ein wichtigster Punkt, wichtigster Unterschied, das ist Moskau, also das ist Russland und Imperium, also imperiale Ordnung. Aber dabei gibt es auch rein methodologisch zu betrachten die gegenseitige Wirkungen zwischen dem Zentrum und Peripherien, ja. Also da konnte man auch sehr nützlich postkoloniale Theorie sein, wie Zentrum, also ehemalige Kolonie und das Zentrum gegenseitig einander beeinflussen.
So, it is quite striking, the similarities between ex-Yugoslavia or Serbia in that case and Georgian history or Caucasian history. Sometimes I'm quite struck by it when I read Georgian history books, then I find a lot of similarities. But there's an important difference, which is Moscow and Russia and the imperial order imposed by Russia. And when it comes to the methodology, it's quite interesting to look at the mutual impact that the center and the periphery have on one another. It's like a post-colonial theory that like the imposing or the colonial forces and the peripheries or the colonies have on one another.
Und ein Beispiel werde ich nur nennen. 1989 erscheint eines der letzten Interviews von Andrei Sacharow. In diesem Interview, das war so groß der Skandal für in Georgien, bezeichnete er Georgien als kleines Imperium. die sich irgendwie Moskau imitiert. Und das hieß, wie die georgische Nationalisten mit den ethnischen Minderheiten umgehen und vor allem mit Abchasien und Ossetien. Und praktisch, die imitieren Imperium damit, dass sie genauso mit Abchasen und Osseten umgehen, wie Moskau mit Georgien umgeht oder mit anderen Republiken. Und also Sacharow hat jetzt keinen Forschungsplan oder Forschungsmethodologie gezeigt, aber das könnte auch methodologisch benutzt werden, genau aus dieser postkolonialen oder postimperialen Sicht, dass ehemalige Kolonien sozusagen imitieren oft, ohne es zu merken, das imperiale Zentrum und imperiale Politik.
There's just one example I would like to refer to Andrei Sakharov when in 89 he proclaimed that Georgia was behaving like a small imperial power. And this was a huge scandal in Georgia, of course. He said in his article that Georgia tried to imitate Moscow and tried to shadow what they have done with their ethnic minorities. So it would basically behave exactly like Moscow behaved with Georgia and the other former republics with Abkhazia and Ossetia in its own country. And it was not displayed as a research methodology, but it could be used as one indeed. So what has been done by Sakharov to refer to this post-colonial theory that the former colonies sometimes tend to imitate what their former oppressors have done with them. So
we can give the floor to our new participant.
Yeah, I'm Olsi Lele, and I'm an anthropologist by profession, so I'm trying maybe to get a contribution in this discussion. Because the first question I was also sharing with a colleague back then is like, where do the 90s begin and end, first and foremost? So the very idea of time, how to frame it, becomes quite problematic in order how we are raising a question in understanding the very limits of history and what 90s do, are what are they able to tell us. And the second, in anthropology, there was this moment in vogue to pose this big question related to the 90s with two different approaches. First, in the question of what was socialism, and here I recall Catherine Verdier's question, to provide the overarching question on to understand, because this is the first thing that the 90s bring us in terms of history and anthropology, is to pose the very first question, how the 90s begin, how they emerge, because it's the moment that the 90s emerge as a rupture, the fall of socialism. But the fall of socialism poses the very question of what socialism was. So this is the first question that brings us to our attention. And we see that there is a multitude of anthropological work done, ethnographies, microhistories, political science, publication about giving the variety of socialisms in the whole reality. So this very notion that the 90s is a plurality of worlds in understanding what socialism is. So this is the very first question that comes. And the second question that comes back is, what comes next? This is the transition. And here, like, then we have this contribution by conferences of Chris Sun and Humboldt scholars, together with many researchers, in posing, giving direction of transitology, like where societies are going and what were themes. And we see a variety of themes over there, like, So from what happens, and post-socialism, it's in itself, it's not even, it's a time frame that is not even ideological per se, as socialism was, as a unit in a kind of an idea that brings a certain relationship. So lots of varieties and lots of trails lead to different approaches. And honestly, the 90s is not isolated only to Soviet Union and the collapse of Yugoslavia. I mean, there is a whole world collapsing in it. Like, we have the Iraq war, on the other hand. Like, we have a totally new wave of thinking about the world, where no big ideologies are prevailing. So there is a total change in the way how histories are being approached. So coming back to the experience of, let's say, Albania, which is the country I've been working on. I mean, the 90s, it's a new way, it's a totally a new structure change. In the way how official history starts being revised, and lots of themes being brought up in the panel are articulated within. But on the other hand, there are also other ways how history is being called. For example, in the 90s, we have also the neo-Ottomanism as a new flex in rewriting history for the Balkans. So despite the national histories within the countries, we have also these other waves in rewriting histories in the area. So in this sense, the overarching concept of socialism and post-socialism, I think, are important tools upon which a good scholarship has been wrote and providing some answers, and eventually not giving solutions, because there is no question, or it's not the idea of giving solutions, but providing a sense of the symptoms of what the 90s are. And I think we have quite a good scholarship on that, like, because sometimes there was this sense that there is things that have been done, but yet we lack yet scholarship on it. So that is my comment on the 90s.
Thanks very much for your comment, and I'd like to apologize to a previous discussant for chasing him away, maybe abruptly, but maybe we could add another chair. I think we had two at the beginning, if somebody has a... It's not your fault, and I encourage you also to join us. Does anyone from our esteemed panel have a reaction to this intervention right now? Corina?
Yes, I mean, we were asked to make history complicated, and you made it even more complicated. Of course, it is. And I would like to mention only one thing, like the term socialist and post-socialist and post-socialist studies. Even this term can be discussed, because when I just had a workshop in Vilnius, and I talked about socialism, post-socialism, I was taught that this is not understandable for people in Lithuania, because they talk about Soviet times and about post-Soviet times, or the time after sovereignty. So, I mean, this already imposes a certain position, so we even have to start thinking about the terms we are using.
Both terms are born in the 90s. So I'm talking about what concepts are born in the 90s. And in terms of historiography, I mean, even the concepts how to frame that period of time are important in understanding, of course, any term. Even the histories, being rewriting the histories, I mean, goes back from the 70s. And meanwhile, the countries that we are referring have been living in monumental histories. Solid modernity in this sense. And the 90s brings this idea of fluid modernity, where history needs to be rewriting, revision of histories. And due precisely because the categories that we challenge are not anymore, they do not help us. But sometimes this, precisely because they do not help us, forces, the power in societies, sometimes benign and sometimes good powers, democracy, even the very sense of it, should be cultivated as a good power instead of nationalism, that still they fish on the same concept of relativity, of values. So, and in this sense, revising history becomes a game of power, a power game. So it depends who is revising history and for what purposes. And so that's why the concept becomes, we do challenge them in this sense, but they are born precisely in this area. This was my idea, and inviting the panel in it. Like,
thank you so much. I would like to propose a title for maybe the second, the next year's history forum, Make History Complicated Again. I think we should write it down. Yes, please.
Okay. Olsi and I, we work in the same department for a long time, but we, of course, share same views in some aspects and others we don't. Well, yeah. I mean, I have a lot of questions, but I will stop. I would like to reflect on the question of complicated history. Because, I mean, why I am interested very much on that is because, as far as I see, is that, okay, speaking in terms of ethics, we learn and we reflect our students to reflect and to take time and to think that history is very complicated. And that's true. On the other side, we have other perspectives on the past who make it very simple and are very successful in public discourse. So, for instance, are conspiracy theories who are becoming very publicly successful. So the public space, it's day by day dominated by these discourses, who, at least in countries that I'm also from my perspective, from my experience on fieldwork, I mean, I was doing fieldwork on different topics, but at the end, after 2 years fieldwork in Albania, I understood that actually I collected more about conspiracy theories in field, because people now believe, they share the values and they believe a lot on conspiracy theories regarding particularly when it comes to immigration. So other people come and occupy Albania, and that this country is under this, not only Albania, but Albania is also the part of this conspiracy theory and so on and so forth, and people trust, people believe. So coming to the complicated history and the public debate, as far as I see, we have lose the public debate in terms of critical thought, a liberal thought, whatever we call it. So as a public good, when it comes to science and to reflection and to all this stuff we are reflecting, we are not anymore people who are, let's say, in public debate, welcomed, because even journalists don't like us, because they say, make it simple, make it simple. People want to understand that, yeah? So it's also the technology. It was mentioned, Facebook, Instagram, they're looking for a short message, very concrete, and so on and so forth. So my question is also my challenge myself. I mean, it's not just to be cynical and to pose the question, but question is, what about to think about how to make a complicated more simple to people to understand that what is history and also how to write it? It was mentioned literature and books and the way and stuff and so on and so forth. But still, it's a question. I know it's a challenge, but we are aware. I know you are on. Most of us are aware about that. We have lose this battle in public. And also it's a question, what is happening with universities, with crisis of humanities, and including history and anthropology? And do we still need this pessimistic view on our disciplines, saying always we are not sure about that, not sure about that, take time and so on and so forth? Or we need to reflect, how should we share our knowledge with people, other people? That's my question also. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Briefly to Ivan, because we also hinted about this losing battle. We talked about also...
Milan and I, we talked a lot about this a couple of last days. Because this is, I fully agree with you, this is the thing that is obsessing me, how we are going to proceed and how we can tackle this, what you said, the losing battle, and how we can more effectively, go go against all of this. You know, I clearly remember regarding the history and historiography in 2015, I was doing my field research, and one of the most important historians in Bosnia and Herzegovina, I came across of his interview from the 90s when he published his book, History of Bosniaks. And the interviewer, Senad Pečinjan, mentioned a couple of days ago him here, asked him, you know, your book is criticized because it doesn't have any references. It is more like some kind of, you know, literary work, you know. And he answered on this, oh, really? Thank you for the compliment, because this was my goal. Because, you know, this is what we need now. Because Serbs and Croats, they already have this mythical invented, you know, history. And this was my goal, to produce the same for us, so that we can, you know, effectively, you know, fight against these narratives that are coming from Serbia and Croatia. And then I was like, wow, you know, this is, it was so striking to me when I heard this, you know. And you know, like, and then it came to my mind, you know, that maybe, I don't know, this is what I, to Milan, said yesterday in this despair, that maybe should we start to invent it as well, but invent some positive history or whatever. But this is becoming like really a disastrous situation, at least in Serbia, of course, in the region, in the Western Balkans. Of course, I'm not talking to other places, but this is really, I fully agree with you. And I don't have the answers. I see that in the first panel, they didn't have answers on this, how you can effectively tackle this huge problem.
Thanks, Ion. Just briefly to Georgi, and then we'll get to our new panelists.
Short about conspiracy theory, because it's not only about history and the past, but official position of Georgian government, of Prime Minister of Georgia now, is that the world will rules by a global war party, and nobody knows what is it, what kind of shit is it, but it is official position of first person in the state, yeah? And what can we do in this situation? Yeah? That is the contemporary actually problem, not only in Georgia, but for the American, maybe Trump or his people says the similar.
Well, thank you very much indeed for the very interesting panel, and especially for bringing these perspectives of the Balkans and of the Southern Caucasus together. I will come back to the question of the narratives from the 90s, since narrative is more or less my specialty, and from this point of view, historical narrative and conspiracy theory are both kind of narratives, but they are differentiated by their connections to history and reality. And Georgi was speaking, I think, in a very enlightened way, a way about these connections and similarities between Balkans and the Southern Caucasus or Soviet Union. But I think in the narratives there are still a very big difference, which is crucial and which is also originated in the 90s. So this is one of the fundamental 90s narratives, that the collapse of the Yugoslavia was a violent one, and then the collapse of the Soviet Union was a peaceful one, which is a narrative, but not necessarily a true one, because Georgi told the story about the civil wars in Georgia. I think you mentioned that in Russia there were no civil wars, which surprised me, because we had two Chechen wars in Russia, which are civil wars. So, and answering your question, maybe it is indeed correct to see the whole post-Soviet history started from 1990s, or even starting from the Karabakh war between Armenia and Azerbaijan, as a big civil war of collapse of the Soviet Union, which still is not fought to its end, right? And this is the way how this narrative indeed shapes our perception even today. So even today we are, if we accept, let's say, the narrative of the peaceful collapse of the Soviet Union, we are seeing things which are happening now in an absolutely different way. And we will see the events of today in a very different way if we accept that the Soviet Union's collapse was not peaceful and is not peaceful at all. And I will also continue Georgi's mentioning of Sakharov in this really brilliant interview for Aganyok, where he continued. So he did not just mention that Georgia is only an empire, but the Soviet Union, also Russia, is a big empire. And we all have to give the sovereignty of our republics back, let's say. So this is these were my two points. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody have a quick response, or can I give the floor to our new participant, Edin?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all for inviting me. And I don't wanted to, but you just picked me from my chair. I don't think that the I had maybe questions before, like dealing with the things of socialism and stuff like that, and things with about nationalism and stuff like that. But I don't think that this is the right way of reacting to some kind of mythological narratives, you know, without footnote, without scientific approach. Why? Because the solution is not that to react on unscientific narrative with unscientific narrative from another perspective, because you're just entering the circle of heroism, war, violence, and you are just deepening it. And I think that the part of solution is that maybe a good solution was like a historian from Croatia, that my colleague, that almost succeeded to criminalize a fascistic salutation in public space by daily and every day and every week education on such an unscientific level for the whole masses, you know, and he gave this kind of, I would like to say, sacrifice, not being anymore in scientific, in academy. Okay, I will go to television. I will every day keep going and talk about Ustasha regime and that kind of stuff. And I think that I just wanted to say that like a fighting with the same armors is not the solution, and we are going to the same circle of violence, and that's it.
Of course, I fully agree. It was a joke. That I think that this is the. I was just quoting the. I know. I'm sure that you know who I'm talking about. So this is a disaster. But what is interesting, by the way, about the Ustasha salute. We can again agree, you know, that one of the leading guys who was introducing the Ustasha salute was again one of the most respectable historians in Croatia. So he was a minister, by the way. So, and one of the leading historians, he was introducing just another interesting, you know,
side note.
Please do. Not just very good connected with the mainstream nationalistic politics in Croatia, but very good connected with the nationalist historians in Belgrade. They are good friends, you know. Chetniks and Ustašas are very good friends in Croatia. And so, thank you.
International, yes. Just a quick reminder for everybody, we have a little more than 5 minutes. So to our original panelists, if you have some closing remarks forming, this is the time, and we welcome.
Just a very, very micro remark to what you said before. Why not issue a book in two versions, one with footnotes and one without?
Thank you for that, for the brevity as well.
Now I'm on your right side. I am not on the left side. And I agree with you totally, but it has to be on it has to be based on a scientific narrative. It has, yeah, we agree. Thank you. That's all.
Srđan, quickly.
Thank you very, very quickly. I'm Srđan from HABE's Belgrade office. Just one small, maybe something that we didn't mention so far, that about the archives and the role of the archives in history, in historiography, in particularly, and speaking about former Yugoslavia, we have to mention the importance of the archives, particularly having in mind that that war was probably one of the best documented wars in history, with the archive of the ICTY, of the International Criminal Tribunal for former Yugoslavia. But even there is one German journalist, Michael Martens, who is writing for Frankfurter Allgemeine, I think, and he's about to release an article about the reactions of German politicians here on Franjo Tuđman's comments that he made a deal with Slobodan Milošević to divide Bosnia and Herzegovina back in 1991. So I think that in that regard, even when we speak about the archives, we have a lot of big problem with the archives in Belgrade and in other countries, but maybe in also in Berlin, now some new archives are opening. And now I think that distinguished panelists and speakers already spoke. The problem is, particularly when it comes to Serbia, maybe, and to some other countries of the Western Balkans, is that historians or scientists, social scientists in different studies, for example, in political science, I'm speaking as political scientists, are completely ignoring these facts coming from the archives, learning from the archives. But I think that we spoke a lot during this session. Thank you.
Thanks much, Srđan. Stick around. Does anybody have a final word or a reaction to one of the previous interventions or to Srđan's?
Maybe I have a short note. Thank you for once again mentioning the very many archival sources, and not only archival sources. We have a lot of sources on this period, and we really have to start working with them. And then we can write books with footnotes and also without footnotes. And our task will, I think, will also be to show the different paths which were taken, because it's not, it's for us an absolutely unanswered question why, for example, in Ukraine in the 90s, things developed very different from Russia or from Moldova. And so we really have to start thinking about the different paths, the different possibilities, and which roads were taken. Thank you.
Thank you, Corina. Georgi, would you like to add thoughts?
Ja, Archive sind eigentlich zugänglich und man muss auch viel lesen. Also gerade in Georgien, wie die Situation ist mit so Vergangenheit und Forschung der neueste, jüngste Geschichte. Es werden zwischen den Narrativen, also ein Narrativ gegen ein anderes Narrativ. Und sehr oft ist das Problem, dass man genau in den Archiven oder in den Bibliotheken auch nicht reinschaut, was damals geschehen ist, welche Publikationen kamen, wie die, also zum Beispiel, es gibt jetzt also Videoarchiven, ja, und Videomaterialien. Es gibt ein Video, wo der erste georgische Präsident Gamsachurdia behauptet, dass es keine abchasische Nation gibt und bezeichnet Abchasien als einen Stamm, die Stämme. Also das weiß jeder, weil auf den YouTube steht. Aber was damals in den Zeitungen veröffentlicht wurde, also ich kann mich erinnern und teilweise habe ich diese Zeitungen auch zu Hause. Aber man muss auch diese Zeitungen aus damaliger Zeit genau lesen. Also das wäre auch ein methodologisches Problem.
Well, thank you. Yeah, when it comes to the archives, they're indeed quite accessible, but we just have to read them more. We have to take them more into consideration when it comes to the appraisal of the past in Georgia and the more recent past. But the problem is that one narrative is usually played against the other, so we don't really find a neutral stand. So we do have to look more into what the archives and the libraries have to offer. And now we have a lot of footage, we have a lot of video material that is displayed on YouTube, for example. So there's one of those videos where we see that the first president, Gamsakhurdia, claims that there has never been such a thing as the Abkhazian nation. They have been a tribe, according to him. And everybody knows about it because you can see it on YouTube. So I do remember what used to be published back then in the newspapers, because I read the newspapers and I do have them at home. But we have to take it more into consideration, and it might be as well an interesting methodology to consider.
Thank you. And just for the end, to make again a bit, I think, more difficult. And what Jordi said now about the accessibility to archives and everything, I am aware to which degree, for example, if you're talking about the former Yugoslavia, and again, coming back to the imperial, mini imperia, so Serbs and Belgrade, because as a former capital for former Yugoslavia, all archives, or let's say predominantly archives are in Belgrade. So our dear friends from Bosnia, Kosovo, and other places, they have a hard time very often to get to the archives, or even they are not permitted to see a lot of things. So again, this is a power play, because Serbs are in much better and better position to dictate and to even sometimes not allow the full access to. I know that a lot of my friends had this problem in Serbia. Regarding some very important archives. So just this as maybe to add regarding the archives and accessibility to those.
That's not really an optimistic note that we are ending on, so thank you for that. I'm kidding. Thank you all very much to our dear panelists, to everybody who has participated also from the audience. It has been very lively. To the interpretation, which was nothing short of spectacular, I must say. And let's have lunch, everybody. Thanks.